we are reading Blizzard's Wake by Phyllis Reynolds Naylor. Chapter 1. March 14th, 1941. Bismarck, North Dakota. Ezekiel Floyd Dexter! Even without the Floyd, the prisoners knew it was Zeke's turn. The slight sandy-haired man with pockmarked face and the cigarette scar on his lower lip rose slowly from his bunk and moved toward the door of his cell. A heavy-set guard in his green and white uniform came into view. He was holding a large paper bag and stopped outside Zeke's cell. Pushing his glasses up further on his nose and holding them there with one finger, he studied the list stapled on top of the sack. One hunting jacket, one wool cap, one pair of gloves, he read aloud. One flannel shirt, one pair of trousers, one set of underwear, one pair of socks, one pair of work boots, watch, wallet, and $7.23. Then removing his fingers so that the glasses slid back down again, he added, "Anything missing? You tell the captain." At that, he put his key in the lock, opened the door of the cell, and handed the bag to Zeke. "You change now? We'll go to the office," he said. He leaned one large hand against the wall of his corridor and crossed his feet, waiting. There were low murmurs up and down the cell block. The men were not allowed to talk with other prisoners cell to cell. But when a man was being released, a guard sometimes allowed the men to say their goodbyes. And so they began to call out softly at first, then a little louder. "Hey, Shorty, you gonna get you a steak dinner tonight? You gonna get hisself a steak dinner and the biggest ice cream sundae this side of the Mississippi?" came a voice from the far end. "He gonna get more than that," said someone else, and the men laughed. And then from the other direction, "Don't forget us now. I'll be out before too long." "Hey, Buzzard," someone joked. "He'll be a granddaddy before you're out of here. And that's the truth." Zeke opened the large sack and caught up in the aroma, lifted it to his face, inhaling his own scent. Shut up in a prison locker for 3 years, 5 months, and 6 days, he had his choice of these. The clothes he had been wearing when he was arrested, or the shirt and trousers in the satchel his brother had brought him when he went before the judge for sentencing. Because it was March, he chose his heavy hunting clothes. Zeke took off his prison uniform and dressed quickly. Not so much out of the eagerness as because of the cold. As Zeke was pulling on his boots, the guard said, "Lucky for you, it was October when you came, because you go out of here in summer clothes, you're likely to freeze to death." As a slight man lacing his work boots, the leather stiff from disuse, or whether he should answer at all. "Rule number 7, you must approach an officer in a respectful manner. Always salute him before you speak. You must confine your conversation with him strictly to business at hand. You must not address an officer on matters outside the prison." So he said nothing. When the guard looked his way again, Zeke was standing beside his bunk, holding the empty sack in one hand, jail clothes in the other. "Just leave him on the bunk," the guard said. Zeke picked up the small satchel at the foot of his bed and followed him out into the corridor. Now, more out of boredom than friendship, perhaps, other prisoners gathered at the doors of their cells for the leave talking. Some sullen and envious, some smiling. "So long, cowboy. Get you a shot of Jack Daniels and have one for me. You play the horses, Dexter. 14's your lucky number." There were 7 locked gates between the cell block and the prison entrance, and Zeke Dexter waited silently beside each one as the guard inserted his key. He had not slept well that night before, because his life seemed as uncertain beyond the gates as it had appeared to be 3.5 years ago coming in. They went to the captain's office, and a pudgy man in uniform opened a folder and took out 2 sheets of paper. "You sign these, Zeke, and you're on your way," he said. "You're putting your name to the fact that we've given you back everything you had on you when you came in. Somebody coming to pick you up?"
"Don't think so," Zeke murmured,
reaching for the pen the captain offered. "No? Didn't tell anyone your good time got you an early release?"
"No, sir. Couldn't reach my brother. He'll find out soon enough. Not much to dance about, I figure," Zeke said.
He signed his name below the captain's and the date next to that. The captain smiled, softened. "You get your laugh under control, Zeke. You can make something of yourself."
"Yes, sir."
"I'll have a man bring the truck around and give you a ride to the bus station. You're going back to Grand Forks?"
"Nowhere else to go."
"Well, here's bus fare, then." The captain reached into a drawer, took out some bills, and put them in an envelope. Then he came around the desk and handed it to Zeke. He grasped his hand, his other on Zeke's shoulder. "And I'll say to you what I tell every man when he leaves here.
If I never see you again, it'll mean you've turned yourself around. And if I ever read anything about you in the newspaper, I hope it'll only be that you've not only paid your debt to society, but done a little bit more. Yes, sir. Then his work boots, making an unfamiliar noise on the tile floor, his chest warm beneath his long-sleeved underwear, flannel shirt, and heavy hunting jacket. Zeke lumbered out to the front of the entrance and stood just inside, waiting for the prison truck. His fingers toyed with the shape of the coins inside his pocket. It had been such a long time since he touched money. Rule number 6, you are not allowed to have any money on your person or in your possession. Outside, a lone bird flew across the gray North Dakota sky, circled, and came back again before it disappeared. It struck Zeke that now, if he wanted, he could step outside, and followed the bird's flight with his eyes. He wasn't confined to the view from one narrow window, where birds appeared for an instant like a dash mark on paper. You could never see where they came from, never tell where they went. A pickup came around the building and pulled over to the entrance. The elderly driver leaned forward slightly, eyes scanning the front hall. Zeke turned and took one more look behind him, the captain standing just down the hall, the warden's office to the left, and straight ahead the gate to the cell block from which he had came. Rule number 35. Cursing our flag, our country, or state, or national government, or this institution is strictly forbidden, and if reported, will be punished. Ezekiel Floyd Dexter, age 28, sentence, 5 years, crime, negligent homicide, pushed through the double doors and walked without expression to the passenger side of the trunk. That is the end of chapter 1. I do hope you enjoyed that, because this was one of my favorite books from when I was a child. And if you would like more, please like and comment. Also, please subscribe! I hope y'all are having a good time. I know 2020's been so hard. Oh, the election's been horrible, but we can do it. I believe in us. Have a good day.